The love of the land and farming have always been a great passion of Ian Douglas Smith. He finally describes his particular love of cattle breeding and husbandry.
I have always been more interested in cattle than any other branch of farming. However, when I first started after the last war, I did grow tobacco, and this was in order to give me a quick return crop. Cattle is a long-term project. From the time you start, it is very often 3-4 years before you get any return from your investment. So I grew tobacco, and it served a purpose. It helped me to establish myself. But for the last 10 years or so, I have not grown tobacco. I've concentrated on cattle, which was always my first love. When I started with Herefords. What little money I had at the end of the war and my gratuity, I invested in buying some good Hereford bulls. I crossed those with the best cows that I could obtain. For quite a while, I bred that way. Then I brought in Afrikander bulls and crossed them with the Herefords. This is a cross that is very well known in this part of the world. And as far as commercial ranching is concerned, it is definitely a system that pays dividends. You get your hybrid vigor from crossing the two different breeds. Then after running Afrikanders for a while, I went back to Hereford bulls. And today my herd is more Hereford than anything else, although you can detect the Afrikander train. Well, now my most recent innovation is Brahman bulls. I have my own small pedigree Brahman herd, and I have been bringing in Brahman bulls for the last 2, maybe 3 years now. So again, I am bringing in a system which gives hybrid vigor through what the scientists call heterosis, by crossing two breeds which are far apart. The Hereford is one of the what we call exotic breeds, which comes from Britain. It is a Bos Taurus, whereas the Brahman, like the Afrikander, is a Bos Indicus. And the further away the two breeds are that you cross, theoretically you are supposed to get the greatest hybrid vigor. So this is a policy which a number of commercial ranches use in order to produce the maximum amount of beef. So that's basically the philosophy that I follow in breeding my commercial cattle. Gone are the days when farming was simply a way of life. You have to be efficient, you have to farm economically today, otherwise you simply don't survive. That's the long and the short of it. I'm very lucky, as far as my farming operations are concerned, that I have a number of faithful people who have worked with me for many years, and in some cases, ever since I first went on to my farm. And today, they have worked themselves into a position where they are not really regarded as servants or employees. They are part of the farm, almost part of the family. This is the way I have always run my farm, although I say it myself, I think it can be substantiated that in my area I do have a very good reputation for good relations with all of the people with whom I work. If they require any attention, any service, they come to get this from myself or my wife from the homestead. If they require medical attention, we run a little clinic. If they have family problems with their children, or perhaps between a husband and a wife, they come to me and ask me to settle or help them to settle their problem. If urgent medical attention is required, of course we transport them immediately to the nearest hospital. And I am in the fortunate position that even at times when labour has been difficult to acquire, I have never had any problems with acquiring labour. We run a little school on the farm, again, which I built in conjunction with the people who used the school, who voluntarily gave of their assistance, the materials I provided. And it is only a small school which takes them through the primary school stage. Once they have passed through that, it is necessary for them to then go on to the town for the senior or the secondary school education. But this is a great asset. It is something which is sought after by farm employees, the means of educating their children when they are remote from a centre where there is a big school. And this applies particularly to the little chaps. Once they get a bit older, then it is accepted in Rhodesia, it always has been, that it is fair to send children away to boarding school, the same way as I myself went to boarding school once I had passed out of the elementary school. So these are the kind of things that we try to do. We try to live as a big family unit. And everybody knows that he is working for himself. I have a bonus system, so they know that the better the farm does, the harder they work, the greater is their remuneration. And I have two outstanding people who, as I have said, have been with me for over 20 years. One of them, Makwera, who is in charge of my cattle operations, and the other one, whose name is Amos, who is in charge of the agricultural operations. And with all the experience they have behind them, they are outstanding at their work. They can carry out their work in the way that any average person would do, be he black or white. And some of the things that they are able to do have surprised many of my friends when they learn how capable these people are. And in view of the fact that I have had to be away from my farm for long periods over the years now, and this goes back to the time even before I was a cabinet minister. In those days, I was only a half-time farmer. So more and more responsibility has gradually fallen onto the shoulders of these people. And I'm happy to say they have accepted the responsibility and acquitted themselves very well indeed. In fact, I think they almost believe that they are part owners of the farm now. Makwera and everybody else in the farm talk about Makwera's cattle when anything happens to the cattle, and they talk about Amos's lands and the mealies, the corn which is growing. I believe that this is the right sort of spirit to engender amongst these people. You've got to try to get them to feel that they belong, and if you can succeed, then I believe you get repaid doubly. We, of course, have to do things in this part of the world which I don't think they do in countries such as Europe, maybe in America. We do have a tick problem on our cattle, and this means that we've got to dip. In the summer months, we dip weekly. In the winter months, we dip fortnightly. Ticks are responsible for most of the diseases which take a toll of cattle in this part of the world. In the old days, we had nothing other than arsenical dips to use. And while these served a useful purpose, they did have their weaknesses. Today, the position has improved tremendously. We have these modern organic dips which are very effective in cleaning cattle of ticks, and I think I can fairly say that nowadays with the modern dips there is really no excuse to have ticks on your cattle. So as we go along, we try to use better and improved methods and make ourselves more efficient. Of course, because economics is an important part of farming. Obviously, if you can't make it pay, you don't stay in farming for long. In order to ensure that we are getting adequate returns, one of the accepted procedures today is to weigh your cattle at regular intervals. You start by weighing the calf when it is born, and this gives you some idea of the capability of the mother in producing a calf. The next thing you do is weigh it when it is weaned, and this gives you some idea of the mother's ability to feed the calf, to bring it up, her milk capacity. Thereafter, at certain regular intervals, you try to the best of your ability to carry out this weighing procedure. And if you are feeding, as I do, then it is absolutely vital to go through a process of weighing your cattle to ensure that they are gaining weight. Because it's one thing keeping cattle on grass, where they simply eat what is naturally grown on the farm, and putting them in feeding pens where you are virtually putting money down their throats every day. This is hard cash. Because while most farmers try to grow the bulk of the feed which they feed their cattle, there are always certain ingredients which have to be purchased, mainly your protein, whether it is urea or cottonseed cake, for example. And if you don't ensure that your cattle are gaining a correct weight, then of course you can be losing money and losing it fairly rapidly by the day. So again, this is an accepted procedure in Rhodesia, that in order to ensure that the cattle are gaining, we carry out a systematic system of weaning. You see, like most countries in the world, cattle in Rhodesia are subject to worm infestation of the stomach and also fluke infestation of the liver. Now, there are very simple and adequate means of coping with this by a dosing procedure or even an injection. And again, it is fairly easy for a farmer to find out whether his cattle are infested. Tests can prove this. And if your cattle are not gaining weight, it is probably due to one of these reasons, that there is some parasite which is draining it and taking advantage of the feed, which should be going into the animal instead of into the parasite. So once again, here is a simple scientific means which we have at our disposal of enabling us to ensure that we get the best return from the cattle. And once again, it is the economic aspect which is motivating us as far as this is concerned.